Are listening later on through our YouTube channel. What a blessing it is to be found in the house of the Lord once more and again. As we enter into today's services, let's not forget our announcements. Let's continue to give through our methods of giving, through our online giving, through our app, by contacting a member of the finance committee, or by sending through U.S. mail. Reminder, please do not send cash in the mail. We want to thank Sister Arrington and the Arrington Funeral Home for conducting and providing our COVID-19 testing here this past week. It was a huge success. We thank Ms. Arrington for all that she does. We also want to thank all of you who came out to be tested. Also to the Mount Moriah Baptist Church and Pastor Jeffrey Black and his congregation for them joining in to make all of this possible. And to all of those with the Galilee Baptist Church that showed up to help in any way. Your efforts were truly noticed and does not go unnoticed. And Pastor would like to say thank you to each and every one of you. Let's not forget our children's church. We have the information in the GroupMe app to make sure that our children stay engaged in their worship services that will begin after our services this morning. And finally, our Bible challenge. We started the challenge last week with giving out clues coming from the 27th chapter of Matthew. And I'm going to help you cheat a little bit. We started with the conversation that Jesus was having with Pontius Pilate. Now you have to read it to know more. But if you really want to bring on the baby, we can talk. But there will be a shipping and handling fee for the bride money. So the conversation won't come for free. But we do encourage all of you to be engaged. Immediately after the conclusion of Pastor's Bible study on Wednesday night, we'll go into our Bible challenge. And just so that you know the rules, you have to be quick with it. When I give you the questions, you should be typing in the answers. You don't get the opportunity to study and then send the answers in. You have to send them right then. Because Sister Carlisle has been studying for a long time. So, but we encourage you to be engaged in this Bible challenge. Again, for the prize money of $250 prize. We just want to let you know that we're thinking about you and just a small blessing that the church wants to do to keep you involved with what's going on. Amen? Our scripture will come from the book of Isaiah, the 40th chapter, beginning with the 25th verse through the 31st verse. It says, "To whom then will ye liken me, or shall I be equal?
you are wise, somebody better tell her thank you. Thank you, Jesus, for keeping me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. The psalmist said it this way in Psalms 144, chapter, the first verse, that he is the Lord my rock that teaches my hands to war. That means my hands go up and we say thank you. That means my hands clap and we make a song unto the Lord and we say thank you. Job said it this way, that though you slay me, yet will I trust in you. I tell you thank you for the good and the bad, the up and the down. We say thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, we bless your name, oh God. There's another song that says it this way, that we give them a sacrifice of praise and a sacrifice of worship. We say thank you, Jesus, for all of the things that you have done. Oh God, we bless you today. We bless you today. Would you begin to talk to your Father as we begin to tell him thank you? Begin to talk to your King. Begin to talk to your Savior. Begin to talk to your Healer. Oh, begin to talk to your Reviver. Begin to talk to your Redeemer. Begin to talk to your Waymaker. Begin to talk to your Burden Bearer. Hallelujah. Begin to talk to your miracle worker. Oh, kind Savior, we bless you today. We say that you are everything that we need you to be. Oh, God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. Oh, God, we beseech you this day. Father God, the one who wrote Revelation said the angels around your throne call you holy, holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty, Father? Before we even ask you for anything, we just praise you for who you are, oh God. We just thank you, oh God, for being the will in the middle of the wheel. We thank you, oh God, for being the Father's thirst while he was on the altar, oh God, on the cross, oh God, calling Abba, Father. We thank you, oh God, hallelujah. Oh God, for being our miracle worker, for being, oh God, hallelujah, our Redeemer, the one who saved our soul, Father. We beseech you this morning. And we thank you for your presence, oh God, and Father. We come to you asking you, Father God, to cleanse us again, oh God, in the name of Jesus, Father. We pray right now in the name of Jesus that you would touch us on the inside, oh God, hallelujah, from the top to the bottom, oh God, Father God, for everything that we have said, everything that we have done or even thought, oh God, that was not pleasing unto your name, oh God, in the name of Jesus, Father. We pray, oh God, as we hold on to the brazen altar once more and again, oh God, we ask that you would wash us in and out, oh God, in the name of Jesus, Father. You saw fit that you would bless us, oh God. Continue to lead afresh. I lead from the anointing of the kingdom of God.
it brief for the sake of time, and it says, and he said, wherefore wilt thou go to him today? It is neither new moon nor Sabbath. And she said, it shall be well. It shall be well. For the time of light, for my sermon and thought, I want to preach from the subject, make room for God to move. Make room for God to move. January the 1st, 2020 was the first day of the year. And as the world began eager to start a decade, many honed in on the fact that this year we would see crystal clear. In fact, many were saying that this would be the year that we would have 2020 vision. This thing could be found on social media, could be found in preaching from preachers in the pulpit. Everyone was saying the same thing, that this is our year for clarity. But little did we know in which the manner that our clarity would come. Several months after the beginning of this year, state by state, governors were telling everyone to stay at home. We are better together. No one could clearly see that this season would produce so much loss. Loss after loss. And many have lost loved ones to COVID. Many have lost loved ones to other diseases. And many are grieving the loss of not being able to bury their loved ones in the manner in which they desire. Grieving the loss of jobs. Grieving the loss of money and cars and houses. The loss of sending our children to school in a different way that we don't know. The loss of not being able to see your doctor face to face. So many losses to count in this year, and yet this year isn't over. But we became confined in our homes, and no longer were we able to do the things outside of our house that we normally do. Isolated from life, friends, jobs, and anything that we deemed the norm came abruptly to a halt. Many that felt in control about their life was left now feeling out of control. But many can attest that this pandemic has robbed many of their self-control. That very thing, that very plan that they thought they had is now all over the place and left us looking stressed and speechless to what was taking place right before our very eyes. The devastation of George Floyd and the pandemic alone is enough to send our anxieties beyond our comfort level. And to add insult to injury, everyone must wear a face covering when entering a business. This alone has caused the sense of suffocation, and many, like George Floyd, are left saying, I can't breathe. I don't know about you, if you've ever been out of breath.
Devastated.
and not making room for what they need to make room for. To the one that has been faking strength in this season and not making time for the important thing. But as I preach to you this morning, understand that distraction is a trick of the enemy, because the enemy likes devastation. Because if he can see you devastated, he can use that to distract you from what God is trying to do. We know God to do things decently and in order, and in the devastation that we can sometimes not see clearly. Because of the crisis, we fail to look to Christ, who is the author and finisher of our faith. I came to preach to somebody today that you can't be so focused on what's going on around you, that in front of you and beside you, that you forget who's working on the inside of you. You have to refuse to be that person that allows your emotions to overpower your intellect. In other words, I can't be so wrapped up in what I see that I forget about who I know and whose I am. And here, at the point of our chips, we find that temporary personification of that very thing. That we come onto the scene of the Shunammite woman's son is dead, and she's in fight mode. I believe I'm talking to some people today that can say, yes, I've had some devastation in my life. Yes, I've had my share of problems, and I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know which way I'm going to turn. And I came to encourage you today, my brothers and sisters, that whatever you face devastation, you can either do two things. You can fight or you can fight. I came to preach to you today that you've got to learn how to fight in this season, because there's a fight in all of us. We just got to learn how to breathe it out. Learn how to breathe it out. I know some people are falling apart at the state of what's going on in our world. Some people are falling apart because they can't see their loved ones. Some people are falling apart because of everything that is going on. But if you just fight, this woman was just graceful, and she wasn't just peaceful without having to go through some work.
Yeah.
You don't just get to a place of peace without working. And so here it is that we understand that she has gotten to the point, and we're at this point of our text, that here it is that the Shunammite woman, she can't help that she was born into a family of wealth. She can't help that she had a lot of money. She couldn't even help that she could not produce what society had said was a blessing. She was blessed and cursed all at the same time. We have to understand about this woman before we even get to verse 23, that what has taken place, that we have to understand that this woman could not conceive. And I know some of you men may not understand. You cannot imagine what the pain that she may have been feeling. But oftentimes the disappointment of our tangible stuff will cause us to lose sight of the intangible. And you may not see God clearly, and you fail to make room for God. But turn to your neighbor only if they have a mask on. And lay, but not if they got a mask on. If they don't have a mask on, lay your hands on yourself and answer to yourself this morning that you have to make room for God. Yeah, you got to make room for God, because here at the point of our text, we see relationship and discernment. Verse 10 says, let me make a little chamber, I pray thee, on the wall, and tell us, set for him there a bed at the table, and a stool, and a candlestick, and it shall be that when he cometh to us, that he shall turn in thither. NIV says, let's make him a small room. Make room, yeah, in order to make room for a stranger, you have to have some type of discernment. I don't know about you, but if a stranger comes knocking on my door, I'm not just going to say, come on in, you can sleep. So there has to be a level of discernment. And I don't know about you, but relationship has to precede discernment. That when we have a relationship with God, that he will oftentimes cause you to do things that you don't even fully understand. Understand that when you are in relationship with someone, that you have to talk to them enough to get to know them and know their likes and their dislikes. That's why when you're in relationship with another person and somebody brings you some mess that you won't entertain it, because you know that person for yourself. Don't say that. make room for everything else. We make room for our job, but no room for God. We make room to hang out, but we not, don't even make room for God. We make room to do the desires of our heart, but we don't make room for God. But here at the point of our text, it is evident that the woman has made room for God to move. For the Bible says that when she went to her husband, she said, let's build a room for the man of God. Let's pause for a moment and talk about the woman who went to her husband. That she had discernment, but she understood order. That's why she had discernment, but she understood order. Yes, she knew that. She might have felt something in her spirit, but she knew that she couldn't just act on it without her husband's blessing. Because can I tell you something? That's the reason why churches can't grow. Because we out of order. That's the reason why marriages can't grow. Because we out of order. That's the reason why relationships can't grow. But the problem is that we've been out of order so long. Oh, Lord, let me know that. We've been out of order so long that we don't even know what order is. So she went to her husband first with the idea. The Bible didn't say she proceeded to make the room up on her own, but she went to her husband first. The Bible didn't say that she gathered all of the materials and then began to proceed to build the room, but she went to her husband first. And when we operate in order, God will make room for opportunities beyond our wildest dreams. For the Bible tells us that whatever we do, that we need to do it all to the glory of God. Here it is that we could have that he could have allowed her to not have a room. Here it is that he could have just told her, go get one of the other rooms and just move the stuff all out of the way. Yeah, that room that you got all kinds of stuff in. That you clear it out when company comes. That room. He could have told her to go get that room. No, but she made room for him to move as he desired in his room. But not only did she make room for him in the room, she set up the room so that he could come and go as he pleased. The man of God represents the messenger of God, the voice of God, that when God writes to the seven churches, Asia Minor, he calls them the angel of God, the representation of God. And if the prophet is a representation of heaven, what the woman is saying, let's make a place for God. Old Testament, that they made buildings for God to dwell in. New Testament, that now, God said, I'm going away with all that. Now, I want to dwell inside of you. So this woman, she represented, she recognized the awe that was present. She understood that if I'm going to get to where God has for me, that I've got to make room for the awe to flow. You got to make room for the oil to flow. You got to make room for the Holy Spirit to flow, for the pneuma to come in your life and move and do some things that you've never seen done before. But the problem in the church is that we haven't made time for God. We haven't made time for God, that we can quote scriptures, but we're making no time for God. That we can speak in tongues, but we're not making any time for God. That we can pray the house down, but we're not making any time for God. We can come to church religiously, but we're not making time for God. But when we make time for the Spirit, I don't have to worry about the tangible. Because I understand that the intangible is all I need. That if the Spirit dwells in me, if I make room for him to flow, then I'll make better decisions. If I make room for him to flow, then I'll be a better friend. If I make room for him to flow, then I'll be a better person. I'll love them if I allow him to move like he wants. But the problem is that we are allowing all the wrong things to have access in our life. That's why we find ourselves in certain situations. That's the reason why some of you are shacking up. That's the reason why we look at our situation and we don't know where our money's going, because we are allowing everything, oh Lord, to have access. My. Let me go ahead and tell you, excuse me if I don't return your call. Excuse me if it seems like I've ghosted with you. Excuse me that in this season I've got to let some things go in my life. Excuse me if we don't seem like we're buddy-buddy anymore. I'm not going to let anything or anyone stop the flowing of the Holy Spirit in my life. You can call me bougie, you can call me stuck up, but I don't know. At least I'm making room for the oil to flow. Because I understand that I can't allow my minor to be my major. Some people minor in room for God, the major in mess. Oh yeah, that's some people. That may not be you, but some people are minoring in room for God, but majoring in lying. Some people are minoring in room for God, but majoring in laziness. my relationship on Christ so that I can discern the enemy when he comes, because it's not when he's coming, but he's coming. He's coming. He's coming. When trouble comes and I will not be moved by the things that I see, but I'll have discernment from the Spirit that in fact when I make room for God, that devastation comes in front of me, but I still can think clearly and not be moved by my emotions, because my relationship with God will cause me to discern some things. Why? Because I'm in relationship with Him. Because I lie. Because I am His child. And because I'm His child, He's going to move on my behalf. When I was thinking about this, I was thinking about my dad and how I can call my dad, and my dad will come at the drop of a hat to do whatever I ask him to do. Because we have relationship. Yeah. And that's how it is with Christ. That we have relationship. And when we have relationship with Him, that when we call Him, I'm saying His dad, and not our plans. Y'all don't want to talk about that. Sometimes when we seek Him, that means that we go with His plans, not our plans. But this woman, she was lacking. Yet she found the time to make room for somebody else. She put Elijah's need before hers. For Paul tells us they do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility, consider others better than yourselves. This thing could have went another way if she would have put herself before Elijah's knees. But she wasn't worried about a child. She wasn't worried about that. All she was worried about is making sure the man of God had a place to stay when he passed through. So when we are seeking God, we have to make sure that we are putting the right things in the right order. But the problem with so many people is that you're focused on things that you can't change. Rather focusing on things that you can change. She didn't do nothing about not being able to conceive. The Bible didn't tell us that she didn't anything about it. But yes, I'm pretty sure she felt bad. But she made sure that she can make room for the oil to flow. Watch this, that when you make room for the oil to flow, when you make sure that others are cared for, that you will find blessings that will flow in your life. And as you pass forward in the text, I encourage you to read this as you get home, but as we fast forward in the text, we see the decision and the results. For as we get to the end of the 23rd verse, she says to her husband that it is well.
Yeah.
What has happened in the text in between is God has blessed her with a child. She didn't want a child, but she was blessed with it because of her obedience. Because she honored the man of God, God showed opportunity to give her what she never thought that she would have. But the Bible says that now this child is grown. That he has been through toddler years, he's been through preteen years, and now he is grown. Many scholars suggested that the son had a heat stroke, working with his dad in the heat of the day. Isn't it interesting that the Bible didn't say that the dad carried him to the hospital? He carried him to his mom. Isn't it interesting enough that the Bible didn't say that he called the paramedics, but he called his wife and carried him there? Isn't it interesting enough that he didn't bring the fortune tellers? But the Bible says he carried him to his wife. That even though his wife respected order, that he respected his wife to know that he was not threatened by the oil that was flowing in her life. So he carried her. He carried his son to his wife. Carry her. Let this sink in. Carry her to the wife. Because he knew what? That the wife was connected to the oil. So he carried her. And the wife goes in the room and the baby ends up dying. At her feet. Can't you see that here it is, that this child that she never asked for, this child that she's carrying is dead. And the Bible says that he dies at her feet. She's a mom, and I'm pretty sure she was feeling some kind of loss. But guess what? She has not lost her fight. How do we know? So she lays the baby on the bed, goes out the room, closes the door, and she says she's about to go somewhere and get somebody who she knows can do something about it. We've experienced losses in tangible ways, and oftentimes it shakes us and makes us question the tangible loss. herself. She couldn't talk to a spouse. She couldn't talk to nobody along the way. She was silently suffering. Sometimes you gotta cry in private. Sometimes you gotta go through in private. But God is saying that you're suffering in private. I'm about to elevate you in public. Oh, well, the Bible declares that she was on a donkey. She told him don't stop. And she told him don't stop. He kept on going and get to Elijah. And I dare you right now to lay hands on yourself and shout the good news that bring up. If he that is in me, that he that is in the world, that when she gets to the prophet, that she grabs him by the feet. But it isn't that she's grabbing the prophet by the feet. Oh, you got to look at that text real hard. If my spirit alive, she's grabbing the word. What she's saying is, I lay at your feet. I don't care what I'm going through, but I give it all to you, God. Oh, I might have seen some devastation. I might have seen some problems, God. But I can lose my breath. I can lose my shout. I can lose my worship. I've been through hell and back, but I still got my praise. I've been through hell and back, but I still got my shout. I dare you to go to the master for whatever problem that you're going through here. Mostly she goes to Elijah. Elijah figures out what the problem. We're going fast forward. We would text when you get home. She Elijah said, y'all go on ahead. And I'll be on late. No. I'm not leaving until you come with me. Because sometimes when you have a relationship with somebody, you can put demands on them to do something that otherwise somebody else would do. So here it is that she says, no, you gotta come with me. You got to come with me. They go in the room, they get there, they go in the room, they close the door, and they pray. First time, boy, he didn't get up. Second time, they prayed. He gets up. See, we understand that Lazarus got up on the first time, but this boy, he didn't get up. But the Bible tells us that the woman had made a decision because she knew that the results that she was going to be able to see. So as I was looking at the text, I was thinking about when I was sick, and they had given me 2 days to live. I remember my mom telling me that my uncle, who is also now my pastor, comes into the family room. He looks around, he prays, and he says, she is not dead. She's sleeping. She's not dead, she's sleeping. Catch it, because she's not dead, she's sleeping. Guess what? He says to the family, she's not dead, she's sleeping. But did I wake up right then? No. Because sometimes you think that God is saying not right now. He's not denied. He's just saying not right now. Guess this, when I wake up, they put me on puree foods. Why did they put me on puree foods? Because they haven't ate anything in so long. So as I tolerated the puree foods, then they said, okay, now she can tolerate that. We're going to put on some accountable salt. And then after we go for our accountable salt, then we're going to put on whole foods. Oh, what are we doing? We're building up a strength because she's been laying in the bed so long that she's not going to be able to get up her strength to walk. But what it is that they just get me out of the bed to walk? No, every day they came. They stood me up on the side of the bed. You'll catch it in a minute. They stood me up on the side of the bed. They built my strength up. So when the time comes, when it's time for me to walk, that I will be able to walk. That I will be able to walk. Why? Because that signifies that if I go and I lay down and I'm walking, but I fall down, that I'll be able to stand back up. I don't know who I'm talking to. Trying to provide for you because you want to go your way and not his. sermon. Yeah. Oh, this I recall to my mind. Therefore, I have hope. Yeah, it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed because of his compassion. Failing not. All I'm trying to say this morning that I know you may have been going through some things. I know you may have been consumed. But faith is the belief that is coming. And hope is the expectancy of when it will. And as I get ready to close to this woman, she saw the details of God. She saw that God was going to move, that even though she saw the devastation, that she didn't stop from seeing the details. Even though you may be broken across the situations, even though that you may be despondent about some situations, but you can't stop the oil from flowing. You've got to cry sometimes. Yeah. You may be down sometimes, but you got to know that the oil is in your life. Yeah. You've got to know that it's all a part of his plan. Understand, as we look closer to what God is doing, I hear God say when I was in the text that God is doing a new thing. And I don't know where my teachers are, but whenever God begins to do a new thing, you've got to be able to pay attention. Ain't that right, Ron? You've got to pay attention so you won't miss the minor details. What is the minor details of the text? The minor details of the text is that the boy was dead. The boy was dead. But not only was the boy dead, he sneezed. Oh, I did some research, and when I sneeze, whenever we sneeze in our lungs, contract, and they breathe air. Our lungs contract, and they build air. We breathe air. Get this, that. But all I'm trying to say to you is that the enemy will try to make you look at your situation. He will try to make you appear your first appearance of you. But I came to preach to somebody today that you can't be worried about what you see, because you know the God that you serve is there.
Yeah. Brother Brian, I want to thank thank him always. And my beloved daughter, Sister Raven, thank God for all of you. We hope that you were blessed today. Now, there are clues going to be given this evening, so don't forget after service is over. Our youth department is going to do their thing, right? And then they're going to have the clues for the trivia. Am I right?
Yes.
Right. Okay. And then Wednesday night, there are going to be some more clues. Go do the question. And then we're going to give out the money. I do want to tell y'all I'm not eligible. Matthew, you're not eligible yet. Amen. You're disqualified. Amen. May God bless you. May God keep you. Let us all stay. God has smiled on me. Henceforth and forevermore, let us all sing together. Amen.